Well, welcome everybody to Wednesday night at the lab, this very special Wednesday night at the lab. It's great to have people back here. We haven't had a live in-person Wednesday night at the lab in a year and a half. So I'm glad the pandemic's all over and we can take the masks off. Oh, and it's my pleasure to introduce to you Sarah Perdue. She's my colleague in the Department of Physics, and she's the one that approached me about doing this as a joint venture. It's quite an honor to be able to have these joint ventures like tonight, like next week. And so I really appreciate that. And would you please join me in welcoming Sarah Perdue to the lectern?
Thank you, Tom. I just wanted to thank everybody for coming tonight online or in person. It's really great to see everyone here. I will be back to sort of moderate the Q&A at the end. But I'm really just here to introduce our department chair, Professor Mark Erickson. Oh, so please join me in welcoming Professor Erickson.
Thanks, Sarah. Welcome, everyone. It's a real pleasure to introduce Professor Uwe Bergmann, the Martin L. Pearl Professor in our department. As you're going to see, Uwe has energy. And is just a prolific scientist, a wonderful career in so many different ways. Uwe got his PhD from Stony Brook University and has worked at light sources across the country, across the world, in both Europe and the US. He's done a lot of recent work at the Stanford Light Source and at SLAC. His newest lab is right next to my lab, which is fantastic. And he's already got student and postdoc right down the hallway. So Uwe, it's wonderful to have you here. We're really looking forward to this talk.
Thank you very much. It's a tremendous honor to give this lecture today. On November 8, 1895, a discovery changed the world. Wilhelm Conrad Røntgen had discovered a new form of ray of light. And he didn't know what it was because it was invisible. No one had ever seen it, so he called it X-rays. 6 weeks later, this photo of his wife's hand made headlines around the world, and it single-handedly started a revolution in science and also a new discipline in medical research called radiology. Today, we have about 3 billion X-rays are taken every year. And this is only the medical imaging. We are not even talking about the impact of his research in science, which I will focus on. He won the Nobel Prize in 1901, the first Nobel Prize in physics. And when he was asked by a reporter, what were you thinking when you discovered X-rays? He said, I wasn't thinking, I was investigating. There's still some questions which I really cannot cannot understand. How do you get your spouse convinced to lend her your hand to get exposed to some unknown form of rays which no one had ever seen? And oh, by the way, you need to be absolutely still for 50 minutes because I want to make a good image of them. That's really devotion. So the X-rays are in the electromagnetic spectrum above extreme ultraviolet light and below gamma rays, and they are about from about 100 angstrom to a tenth, less than a tenth of an angstrom wavelength. And we love them for various reasons. One, they penetrate matter. That's what Rontgen had discovered. And how much they penetrate matter depends on, first of all, the wavelength and also on what the composition of the matter. And that's how you can get, for example, X-rays. In fact, scientific X-rays do not penetrate quite as much because they're at much lower energy than most of the medical X-rays. But X-rays also have a very short wavelength of order angstroms. And that is really critical because you can then use them to get to do imaging with atomic resolution. And that has been used in many forms of, in many techniques. And X-rays have enough energy to kick out core electrons. So they're ionizing, it's an ionizing radiation. And that makes them a powerful element specific probe of how atoms bond, for example, and what elements are in your sample. All these qualities are unique and have been employed to see the structure of materials on all scales, from macroscopic, which we just saw the hand, even much larger object than the hand, to microscopic, less than the size of an atom. Now, X-ray absorption, the main contribution to X-ray absorption is that an electron is knocked out, and that's why you get this contrast. And like you just saw the image of the hand. This is my friend Hector from Slack. He jumped off his truck and he showed me his X-ray, and you can see the titanium in his heel. It is made out of metal, very dense, and it absorbs much stronger, and that's why you see the contrast very well. And of course, you also see the broken heel and the other bones, which are more dense than the water in our soft tissue. Then the other thing X-rays do, they scatter. So they're basically here, they don't knock out an electron, but they just scatter. And this can be used in itself, or it can be combined in form of diffraction if you have a crystalline structure. And this is probably the most widely used form of using X-rays. And it has also led to this photo, which in my book is possibly the greatest discovery of the last century. It is photo 52 and was taken by the graduate student of a young researcher called Rosalind Franklin. And when it was finally understood, so what she did is she crystallized the molecule, and then she measured the X-ray diffraction, the intensity. So that is what you see here. And then when it was finally understood, it led to the discovery of the molecule of life, the DNA. And this was attributed to Watson and Crick, of course. And there's a lot of history and lots of stories about how this whole discovery came about, and also some controversy. Now, in this audience, there will be probably quite a few who disagree with me. What was the greatest discovery of the last century? After all, we have a very strong particle physics community here in Wisconsin. And Shidara just reminded me today that except for the Higgs, which was discovered in 2012, and except for the photon, all other elementary particles were actually also discovered in the 20th century. So it's hard to compete with that. One of the really amazing people who did such a discovery was Marty Pearl. And you can imagine it's a tremendous honor to have a chair associated with his name. Marty, he used the Slack Linac and also the Slack spear ring to collide electrons and positrons for his discovery of the tau lepton. And he was really, you could see him at Slack basically almost until the end of his days. He was there every day. He was also a very avid swimmer. He was at the swimming pool at Stanford almost every day of his life. And I would like to thank the physics department, the university, and in particular, Franz Himsel, who first contacted me, Cooper Gilbert, who is in the audience, and also Sridhara, who actually helped a lot helped me a lot with coming to this university. It's really wonderful. Now, Marty used the famous SLAC LINAC, the 2-mile linear accelerator. And he accelerated his positrons, which were produced here and then also fed to the back, and his electrons to about from 2.3 to 4 GeV. And then he fed them into the spear ring. This is the spear ring, stands for Stanford positron electron asymmetric ring, where he collided them for his discovery. The spear ring, even in the 70s already, some scientists said, hey, we could use some of this. One of the biggest nuisances in high energy physics is synchrotron radiation, because the electrons lose energy by this synchrotron radiation. Maybe we can use this synchrotron radiation because it has a spectrum it goes from infrared, actually visible infrared, into the X-ray range. And maybe we have a new powerful source of X-rays. That idea already started in the 70s. It was discovered, synchrotron radiation was discovered already in the late 40s. But the first synchrotron radiation center was actually built here in Wisconsin, not far from here. And this was the Tantalus, the 240 MeV Tantalus ring, relatively small. Here you can see five meter radius. And I found this. This was APS President Sam Aronson presenting to UW Vice Chancellor of Research and Graduate Education, Marsha Mailek, commemorating almost half a century of research. And after the Tantalus ring, it was upgraded to the Aladdin electron storage ring. And it's a wonderful facility, which not only delivered cutting edge science for half a century, but also wonderful ground of education for young students in addition to the science. And that's one of the things which I can say is really unique and wonderful about synchrotron light sources. So here's kind of a model depiction. You have maybe an accelerator, a booster, a storage ring, and then you have all these different stations where X-rays come out. And each of those is its own research lab. And when you walk around a synchrotron ring, you can meet scientists from various disciplines. And it's really awe-inspiring of any single day what research is going on at a synchrotron. And here I show you a few of the many synchrotrons. The top are the largest three in the world, Spring 8 in Japan, Advanced Photon Size not far from here in Argonne, and the European synchrotron. Incredible design, the Shanghai synchrotron, and incredible view, the Berkeley synchrotron. And I have two here who are using it, because that's the Golden Gate Bridge back here, and that is San Francisco. This is the world's first synchrotron. And this is the world's richest synchrotron. Does anyone know what that building is? Apple. It's the Apple building. It's the Apple headquarters. It sure looks like a synchrotron, though. Now, another technique, which is unique for X-rays, is called X-ray fluorescence. And it works like this. You have a photon coming in. You knock out an inner shell electron, and this hole is very short-lived, and it's filled by an outer shell electron, sending out a second color X-ray. And the color of that second X-ray is given by the energy difference between the inner orbital and the outer orbital. You can also get electrons out, but often you get X-ray fluorescence photons out. So this is a very powerful spectroscopic tool to actually determine the element. If you get some material, you want to know which elements are in this material, you can determine them by just shining X-rays on them and looking at the fluorescent spectrum, because each element has its own unique color of X-rays coming out. So here's such a spectrum. And if you know your energies, you will find that there's phosphorus, chlorine, calcium, iron, copper. And the idea of using this X-ray fluorescence for quantitative analysis has first been introduced by Costa and Nishina already in 1925 on this really amazing paper called On the Quantitative Chemical Analysis by Means of the X-ray Spectrum. Now, this specific spectrum comes from a really famous old book. This is a 12th century prayer, Byzantine prayer book, which contains the overwritten 10th century copy of the great Greek genius Archimedes' work. And it was Johann Ludwig Heiberg who first discovered it in 1905. And here you can see one of those pages. This is an Archimedes drawing and the text, and here's some of the text. And most pages, so that copy was done in the 10th century. So there's nothing earlier which survives of his work. And it was basically erased, partly erased, and then the parchment was recycled because parchment is so expensive and was recycled. And 200 years later, it was turned into a prayer book. And if you, and they could image quite a few of those pages, but there were also quite a few pages where you couldn't, with visible light, you couldn't see what was written, what was the Archimedes text. And one of those pages is the first folio. Here you see the front side of the first page. And so we developed a technique based on a synchrotron called X-ray fluorescence imaging, where we shine like a very fine collimated X-ray beam on it. And we measure the fluorescence at every spot coming out. And we do it very fast. And we collect pixel by pixel. We make an X-ray fluorescence image of that page. And what we are looking at, we were trying to find iron because we knew that both inks, the overwritten ink, also the new ink was made with an iron gall ink. So if we could get an iron map, maybe we could find some of the text which is otherwise invisible in this two-dimensional X-ray fluorescence image. And this is what we did. Here you can see the writings and the horizontal writings are those by Archimedes and the copy of the Archimedes text, and the vertical writings are those of the Byzantine monk. We sent that out and around midnight, we were so excited. And by 12:30 a.m., Reville Netz, he's a Stanford scholar, already replied. Thanks, Keith, for the images. XRF of one versus column one is sensational. I attached the transcription of lines 2 to 11. Previously, with very hard work, I squeaked out 3.5 lines of the old pseudocolor, and now I can fairly easily read the entire text. Reville Netz was the first to read the final passages of Archimedes' work on floating bodies in the original Greek. No other version of the original Greek had existed until then. Everything we know about on floating bodies had been from a Latin translation. We also found on that first page a corner right here, which contained the dedication, the colophon by the monk who had done the palimpsesting, who had erased it and overwritten it. That wasn't really known. And it was a little bit difficult to decipher, but once the scholars deciphered it, this text said, this was written by the hand of Presbyter Johannes Myronas on the 14th day of the month of April, a Saturday of the year 6737. Now, Myronas used the Byzantine calendar, and the Byzantine calendar starts with the creation. And if you translate that in our calendar, which we use today, the Gregorian, it's 5,508 years offset. So we have, this is the April, the 14th day of the month of April, is in the year 1229. And this this day was the Saturday before Easter. So Myronas was pushing like crazy to get his book ready for the Sunday Easter sermon. And Revilnets could finally read what Myronas had overwritten almost to the day 777 years later, thanks to X-rays. I'm showing you now another historical event. You could argue that this is the most important ride in the history of the United States. And it happened, it was taken by Paul Revere on April 18, 1775. There is a problem with this image though. If you look carefully, it looks like the horse is flying through the air. And it was not until, actually he should have known because this was an early 20th depiction. He should have known that horses do not gallop like that. It was Edward Muybridge who was the first person to take slow motion movies as shots of a galloping horse. And it, this was, it's a long story, but it's based on a bet, are all the four hooves off the ground at any time? And this was his first series. These are 12 images put together, each of them taken with a very short shutter speed. And if you look, if you put them apart, you can actually see that only when the hooves are under the horse, they are off the ground. At any other time, at least one of the hooves, sometimes even two, are touching the ground. So the horse does not fly through the air like it was depicted there. In fact, that's also one of the reasons why horses really do not like to jump. You have to train them hard. They prefer not to have to jump at all because it's not natural to. So Muybridge, so this is an what he used. So this is an improved version. This was with 24. He used these tripwires, and the horse was galloping by like crazy at full speed. This was a race horse. And each tripwire triggered his camera, and it is estimated that it had about 1/2000th pupa, 1/2000th of a shutter speed. Remarkable. So that's how he could get the sharp images. And the whole thing took 1 second. The horse was through this whole thing in less than 1 second. And then you slow down, and then you can see really the motion. Now, since there have been incredible photos using flash photography and other means, where you can reduce the time. So this is exposure time 10 to the minus 4. This is a hummingbird. This one is probably, some of you have seen that. This is a bullet going through an apple, 10 to the minus 6. So that's a millionth of a second, flash photography. You can see, I mean, these bullets are moving fast, and the fact that it's not stretched just shows you how short the exposure is. And if you would take another shot a little bit later, nothing of that apple would be left. It would be gone into oblivion. Now, think about a water molecule. So we all know how it looks like. And water molecules, of course, they do not stand still. They vibrate. They have different modes of vibration. And if you ask the question, how fast do they vibrate? Can I capture the motion of a water molecule while it is vibrating in a similar way like what Muybridge did with the horse? The answer is you need an exposure time which is even 8 orders of magnitude faster than the exposure time I just showed you with the bullet. And if you take that into time, this would be 10 femtoseconds. So in other words, you need incredibly, incredibly short pulses to be able to capture such speeds. And in 1992, my colleague Claudio Pellegrini from UCLA, and he's also affiliated now with Slack, he suggested, he had an audacious idea. He said, why don't we use the LINAC, the Slack LINAC, to create an X-ray laser? And everyone laughed about it. They say it's not possible. You cannot get the magnets good enough. He didn't let himself be put down, and they pursued the idea. And Finally, about 10 years later, funding was awarded, and another 8 years later, the Slack Linux was built. What he had proposed is, I can make a camera which not only has the resolution of atoms, because we are using X-rays, not light, but also the pulses are so short that we can capture molecules while they are vibrating, while they're doing work. We can do the Muybridge experiment, which Muybridge did with a horse. We can do that with atoms and molecules. This is Claudio. And here he explained to President Obama in 2015, after having received the Fermi Award, the highest award any scientist can get from the US government. He explaining to him self-amplified spontaneous emission. And from the look at Obama's face, it suggests that he totally understood every word of it. And this is on April 10, 2009, Slack control room. This is Paul Emmer. He was the lead scientist. And here they're watching. And then finally, they saw this lasing. This lasing created a light source, an X-ray light source, which wasn't 100 times better than a synchrotron, or 1,000 times better than a synchrotron, or 1,000,000 times better. It was 10 billion times brighter than a synchrotron. It had as many photons in 10 or 20 femtoseconds as a synchrotron usually has in a few seconds. And here finally, John Galita, he was the project director, and you see the entire group. It was like, I think around midnight, and all very happy. I'm going to show you now how the Slack LINAC has been turned into an X-ray laser. So we start by kilometer two. We are not using the whole LINAC, and to inject electrons into the LINAC. So you first come in with an electron beam, with a laser beam, and knock out electrons from a copper target. And then these are about 10 billion per pulse are fed into the main LINAC, and here they get accelerated. And depending on the, this is a little slow because of Zoom. We tried it earlier, so you need to be patient. This will be, normally this movie goes a little bit faster. Basically they're accelerated until they have about between 3 and 15 GeV energy, right? So very highly relativistic. And at that point, the electrons are heading into the series of small magnets called the undulators, where they wiggle, and they start to create first synchrotron nidation. And then the photon beam interacts with the electrons to create stimulators, so self-amplified spontaneous emission. And that's when this strong gain occurs. And then the electrons are basically dumped down into the ground, and the X-ray pulses, these short X-ray pulses, continue into where the users are. And that's where the users do the experiments. So here you can see, we are just currently, there are currently some building of some new hutches, but that's roughly how this experiment looks like for an FEL. And this is a typical beamline. So I want to show you what has happened since, partly because of the success of Slack, but also some of them were planned earlier. There are now five, in addition to Slack, there are now five large X-ray laser sources around the world. The European XFEL in outside of Hamburg, Germany, the Swissfel, not too far from Zurich, the Shanghai XFEL, which just got first light on June 25th, very recently, the Sakla FEL in Japan, and the PAL FEL in Korea. And if you look at these pictures, one thing which is remarkable, you don't see it on this one because it's too far away, everyone has a synchrotron ring right next to it. Each of those FELs, and so does the Slack one. They are all built close to synchrotrons because they are much more expensive, they have much smaller capacity, they don't have 60 or 40 beam lines. They have only, you can only do one or two experiments at the time. And you need to do a lot of preparation experiments with other X-ray sources like synchrotrons. This is the latest upgrade of the Slack Linux. And we have a, we are still going to use the copper Linux. And there will be also the a superconducting accelerator, which can go to high repetition rate X-ray pulses. Currently, there are 120 pulses per second. And in the future, they can go up to 1 million pulses per second. So that's basically, if you think of the Muybridge, how close you can put your cameras together. Here, there's just a visual. There are the two undulators at the Slack Linux. There's a vertically polarized and horizontally polarized. And this is the new cryo plant. You need to have a lot of helium to cool those cryogenically cooled accelerators. This Linux, it's right here. So that's at the beginning, and basically it ends up in this direction. And here you see one of those cryo modules, these liquid nitrogen, these liquid helium cryo modules. I want to show you another one. So this is from an amazing book called Stopping Time. And that's another high-speed camera picture. And you see an archer firing an arrow. And I don't think that was intended in this photo. The archer had kind of angled his bow not correctly. And when he released the string, it carved into his flesh. The interesting thing about this picture is, as painful as it was, at the moment this picture was taken, the archer did not know yet, because it takes about a 0.1, 0.2 seconds before, sometimes even longer, if you hit your shin, it takes a few seconds before the pain sets in. And I call this probe before destroy. You get the picture before the damage is at least felt. And I asked, and some person told me that was quite common, actually, that archers had this problem. So recently we had the Olympics at Tokyo. So I checked, I said, what's happening with the archers? And here we go. This is An Sun, a superstar from Korea, 20 years old, 3 gold medals. First time ever an archer won the mixed team, the women's team, and the individual gold medal. And look at, she has a little protection right here, like all the archers, because she knows better. She was just getting ready for another 10 against the Netherlands. That was the end of the Netherlands in this tournament. So this was a concern. It was a big concern that, yes, you have now this very bright X-ray pulse, but what happens to our samples? What happens to our biomolecules? Or what happens to our expensive chemicals, which we want to measure? And there was a group in 2000 already, led by Janusz Hajdu and Richard Neutze, and they said, let's just calculate how long it takes before a protein actually does blow up from being hit by such an intense X-ray pulse. And they estimated at the time that if you do the experiment in something like 5 to 10 femtoseconds, you should be okay. If the pulse gets longer than that, you will only see havoc. Now, this simulation did not include water. So this is a so-called Coulomb explosion, where you remove so many electrons, you have a very strong positive charge, and then from this Coulomb field, you get the explosion. This simulation did not include the water around these proteins. And in reality, we have now found from 10 years or so of research, it was very good. You have a little bit more time. So 20 femtoseconds, 30 femtoseconds is fine. You will not have big damage, depending a little bit on how intense your pulses are. Once you go to 100 femtoseconds, you will lose your sample. And so this method of probe before destroy has been one of the methods which has been now widely used for the last 10 years of X-ray free electron laser research. And so the idea is basically you drop either a molecule or a small crystal or another sample, and you hit them, and you have your big detector, and then with each detector, you get a projection. And you do this experiment maybe 10,000 times or so. And then you realign all the different projections, In this case, it's done for a single particle, but more often it's done for a protein crystal. You realign all of them, all the different projections, and put them together to get the three-dimensional structure. And now I'm going to show you a few X-ray, a few of those movies of what has been done with these amazing FELs. The first one is related to vitamin D synthesis. So vitamin D is an essential nutrient. We need it. It helps our bone growth and other things. And it is also known that you can actually make your own vitamin D when you go in the sun. The UV light of the sun in your skin actually produces vitamin D. In fact, very effectively, more effectively than with supplements. That's why you have to find this balance, not to get overexposed from the sun for your skin, but a little bit of sunlight is actually good. But it also tells me, or told me, and I checked it, that it's actually true, it's not a vitamin, because we can make it something we can make ourselves is by definition not a vitamin. A vitamin is defined as an essential nutrient which you have to get externally. And so I looked it up just for this talk, and it says, yes, it's actually a hormone. So why is it called vitamin D? It just sounds much better than hormone D. Hormone D doesn't sound good. And by the way, if you're a dog or a cat, vitamin C is not a vitamin, because dogs and cats, they just don't like salad and fruit. They make their own vitamin C. So the first reaction, the first step in the synthesis of vitamin D is a ring opening of a cyclohexadiene ring. This is a carbon ring. And the weakest bond is right here. It has two double bonds. This is the weakest bond. The UV light, when you go in the sun, so you have that in your skin, the UV light breaks that bond open. And that's the first step. And this reaction, this ring opening reaction, is not only important for vitamin D synthesis, it's general, it's a prototypical chemical reaction. And that's why it's important. And so my colleagues, led by Mike Minetti and Peter Weber. Peter Weber is from Brown University. Mike Minetti is from SLEC. They dropped cyclohexadiene molecules, hit them with the UV light, and then shot them with X-rays to look from the scattering what happens to those molecules. And by using the scattering signal and a lot of theory and a lot of calculation, they found that these are the three most likely ways that this ring is opening after exposure from this UV light. And in one case, it actually opens and closes again and then opens. That was the case down here. This is a movie of a molecule where the whole movie all together is something like 100, 200 femtoseconds. Unimaginable. And it's an unimaginable slow motion. Another great example is work on carbon monoxide oxidation. So this is what happens in your catalytic converter. When you burn fuel, you create carbon monoxide, and then the catalytic converter converts it in carbon dioxide, because at least carbon dioxide is not toxic. It doesn't kill you. And so they simulated this by having a CO exposed, like a surface exposed, and then heated the surface up to make the oxygens on the surface mobile. And using X-ray absorption spectroscopy, in this case oxygen, they found actually what happens. So if you read the paper, you have to go through this, but I'm going to show it to you on a movie, because I made a movie how it really looks like. So here we have time zero. The heat has not been turned on yet. You have your CO, so carbon, oxygen, two oxygens here. This is the surface. Now he's heating it up, and you see this. This is an animation of the process, and you think it's going to form this bond, but at the end it decides to take the other oxygen, and off it goes as a CO2. Doing such studies really tells you what the fundamental timescales and the fundamental limits of such reactions are, and it's very informative for building better and more effective catalysts. is really like the fundamental understanding of how these reactions work. Now I'm going to take you to the movies. This is one of the really great films, and they even have a musical about it. And it got it won the Oscar for Best Film and Best Director. And it features no less than Gene Arthur and Jimmy Stewart. And I'm going to show you a scene where Jimmy Stewart, he plays a rich son of a banker named Tony Kirby. And he's trying to seduce a young, beautiful girl named Alice Sycamore. And let me show you how he does it.
I remember in college, another guy and I had an idea to... Mind if I talk about myself?
If you don't, I will.
Well, this guy and I had this idea. We wanted to find out what made the grass grow green. Now, that sounds silly and everything, but it's the biggest research problem in the world today, and I'll tell you why. Because there's a tiny little engine in the green of this grass and in the green of the trees that has the mysterious gift of being able to take energy from the rays of the sun and store it up. You see, that's how the heat and power in coal and oil and wood is stored up. Well, we thought if we could find the secret of all those millions of little engines in this green stuff, we can make big ones. And then we could take all the power we could ever need right from the sun's rays, you see?
Well, that's wonderful. I never knew that.
Yeah. Well, we worked on it, day and night. We got so excited we forgot to sleep. If we make just one little discovery, we'd walk on air for days.
Yeah. And what?
Well, then we left school. Now he's selling automobiles. And I'm in some strange thing called banking.
So so this is really mean if you think about it. A banker uses photosynthesis, research on photosynthesis, to impress a young woman. And I think actually it's wonderful because it just shows you how exciting research is, and in particular also how exciting research on photosynthesis is. And this idea, which is incredibly well expressed in this little clip, it is still extremely relevant. And there is an example called the artificial leaf, and there are lots of enormous amount of research of how we use sunlight to actually make fuel. And the first part of this is you need to split water and evolve oxygen. And then you fix basically the CO2 into carbohydrates. And the amount of energy stored in these chemical bonds, in particular in the oxygen which we have in our atmosphere, is just mind-boggling. I'll give you an example. So if you estimate the chemical reaction of splitting two water molecules and creating O2, evolving O2, and then two hydrogens or protons, you gain about 237 kilojoule per mole, and that might not tell you much, but let me tell you, if you take, this is the Wisconsin swimming pool, the new one. If you take the water from that swimming pool, which is about 3 million liters, a little bit less than a million gallon, and you were able to split this amount of water every second, you would create a power of 39 terawatt, which is really unbelievable. If you think about that, currently the world uses 18 terawatt. So all the power we use, all of us together, including my laser pointer here right now, is about 18 terawatt. So you could create, by storing this energy in the oxygen which we have in our atmosphere, you could create that power from splitting one pool of water every second. And in nature, this feed is done by a protein called photosystem II, which is a very large protein. And at the center of that protein, there is a cluster called the oxygen evolving cluster or the manganese cluster, which has four manganese atoms, a calcium atom, and it has oxygens. And it is right there at this location where the two oxygens come together and the O2 bubbles out. And there are many, many groups have been studying this for decades, and we still don't know exactly what this process is. But I have been working on it for 20 years. My colleagues from Berkeley have been working on it for 30 years, and we have done a lot of that work together. In fact, they lead a lot of that effort. And the idea of doing this experiment is you need to come in with four pulses of light. So this is basically, you can use a laser, but it simulates the sunlight. And in each pulse, you change a little bit in this manganese cluster. And after the fourth pulse, oxygen comes out. And so with this X-ray laser, now this one is not a very fast. This is not like femtoseconds. This is relatively slow. But you cannot study it conventionally, because if you want to study a protein like this, you need to freeze it because it gets damaged. But with the X-ray laser, we can actually get these fast snapshots without the damage. And that's how we can study it. And that's how we can expose it. And we can study it at room temperature. We can look directly at the manganese. We can look at the whole protein. And so this particular step is, of course, critical. And so this is a schematics of my colleague. This is done, animation is from Slack, my colleague Franklin Fuller. He led this paper, but it's a really large collaboration. So there are two ways. One is we inject our small crystals in a jet, or we drop them. Now we drop them on a conveyor belt. We expose them to these three pulses of light, for example, can be four. And then a little bit later, we shoot them and we get the X-ray diffraction. And we also get with this spectrometer, we measure the spectroscopy of the manganese cluster. And that's how we try to make a movie of this chemical reaction. Let me just tell you, I believe this is one of the most essential reactions on the planet. Why? Because without it, we would have no oxygen. Essentially, all oxygen in our atmosphere was made by this reaction, and we would not have any highly evolved life forms, not even nothing but bacteria. The Earth would still be a really sad place, like it was about 2.5 billion years ago, 3 billion years ago, before this reaction started. And I'll just show you a short sequence of what we found recently. There's more recent work is focusing on also how the water comes in and other aspects of the structure. So we think we have now a sense that here we see that there are oxygens starting to approach each other. So this is kind of, these are a few my bridge shots, if you want, of this reaction. That's where we are, and we are improving it every time. We have about now 20. So my bridge had 12 for the horse. We have about now 20 different time points, and we are getting close to understanding how this reaction works, actually. This is like, I have so many collaborators, so I just want to show you here. This is a group picture of one of these collaborations where we studied photosystem II, and many we made many friendships and have many many long-standing relationships coming out of this collaboration. And I want to particularly point out the person at the very end. This is my friend and colleague Vitalia Chandra. He's a really wonderful person. I've known him for more than 20 years. I think we have 1/3 or something of my publications are together with him. And he's such a nice man, and he sometimes shouts at me. And it's because I deserve it. I just drive him nuts sometimes. So I want to apologize for that. This is for those who want to go a little bit more into detail. We recently published a paper, it came out earlier this year, which reviews a lot of this XFEL work. And This was my colleagues Jan Kern, Bob Shainlein, Philip Werner, Junko Jano, and Whittle. And if you go to my website at Wisconsin, you can actually download it. It's a little bit hard to get this. If you go to my website, you can actually download the PDF file of the paper. Now, I'm not quite done yet, but I'm almost done, but I'm not quite done. There has been another development, and that started in the 90s, that you can actually also create short X-ray pulses, XUV and X-ray pulses, without an accelerator, but by using a very powerful laser. And it's called high harmonic generation, HHG. And this of course has a huge advantage because you don't need this extremely expensive large accelerator. And this is actually what we are building right now. And there is some really absolutely wonderful spectroscopy you can do with these sources. And the time is as good as you can get in an X-ray laser. The intensity is not as high, so you have to think about which systems to study, but you can do really remarkable work. And so one of the errors is this understanding of functional materials. And again, so you want to control them with light, and you want to know what happens to the electrons when I move, let's say, one electron across the band gap. And how long are they excited? How do they de-excite? Do I create any vibrations, right? Remember the water molecule, can I measure such vibrations? And so all these experiments function the same way. You might have a band gap, you have a conduction band, or sometimes we call it also LUMO, lowest unoccupied molecular orbitals, or valence band, and then you come in with an optical pump and you move one electron up, and then you ask the question, and so what next? And that's what we can probe with X-ray absorption spectroscopy. So we do, we knock out an inner shell electron and it fills this, it now goes into either the vacancy or it goes into the place where, into the empty band. And because you have now moved an electron up in the below the absorption edge, you can have more signal. And above the absorption edge, you will have less signal because some electrons are now excited. And you look at how this changes over time to learn about how these dynamics of these carriers and these holes, how they function. And so this is recently a paper which just came out recently with, we did that together with a group of Steve Leone from Berkeley. And you can, what we found, of course, we found that different. So you see like blue and red is different spectra, but then we also found these interesting oscillations here. You don't see them so well, but if you choose the right energy, you can actually see them. And this is a very distinct frequency. And if you do the Fourier transform of this, you realize that we have discovered two vibrations. One is called an A1G mode, which it looks like this. This is between this molybdenum and tellurium in the system. And the other one is the E1G mode. And they show up. This one is a little weak and this one is a little stronger. So this is a movie in real time of molecules. Here is my new group starting, and I'm happy to see quite a few of them are here. We went to see Bucky, of course. And I want to say that it's really wonderful to be here. I enjoy it. And I look forward to continuing this work with the lab source here, and also, of course, to use some of those larger sources. And we a few years ago, we published a book, again, also Whittle and Junko and I, and our colleague from Japan, he's the director of the laser, was so kind to write a quote. He said the following, and I captured that when he was at Slack. The basis of science is observation. The most fundamental way of observation is by light. X-rays are a form of light that can probe atoms and molecules because they have short wavelength. X-ray lasers can probe atoms and molecules at their fundamental timescales, femtoseconds. Hence, X-ray lasers are one of the fundamentally most powerful tools in science. And with that one, I want to thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Professor Bergmann. We'll take questions from the audience. We can also take questions from the Zoom audience. Tom, you want them just putting questions in the chat? Okay, so if you're in the Zoom audience, please put questions in the chat. We'll check in with Tom. But are there any questions from the in-person audience?
Yes, I was wondering, you showed the various dynamics of the molecule as it was reacting. Have you increased the resolution by collaborating with some computational people to extrapolate in between those steps that you were able to elucidate?
Yeah, so I showed two of those. The first was the ring opening, and the other one was the CO oxidation. And in both cases, in the ring opening in particular, because we have these are scattering data, right? And you don't see this molecule directly. It's like a little bit more indirect observation. And and the team works together with a theoretician from Scotland, from I think Edinburgh, Aaron Kiranda, who does exactly these. And he calculates, he has done 120 different traces of possibilities of how these rings can actually open up. And in one case, because they actually snap open, and then sometimes, usually they snap open sideways, and when they swing back, they don't meet each other. But sometimes they snap open straight and they just close again. And that came, for example, out of one of those calculations. So absolutely. Also the spectroscopy data, all these data, probably the most direct are the protein crystallography, but even the protein crystallography requires a lot of, enormous amount of Fermion data processing. So, but all of them require quite an elaborate theoretical approach to really, you know, be sure that the story is what you think it is. So thank you, yes.
So thank you for that wonderful talk, really enjoyable. So in my field of quantum science, we try and do more with what we have available by enhancing the quantum mechanical properties. And so with light, you can make better measurements and more precise and less noisy measurements by squeezing it or creating entangled light beams. I'm curious if there's any work in that direction in the X-ray regime, which I'm sure would be very challenging and difficult, but perhaps people are thinking about this.
Are you suggesting to use X-rays to manipulate, or are you suggesting you use light to manipulate and then X-rays to probe what's happening?
No, I'm actually asking, can you create quantum mechanical states of X-ray photons that are squeezed X-rays or entangled X-rays?
Yes. It is, as you say, it is really very difficult, but there are groups who are working on it. So the AMO community, with the collaboration, we do some of that work. But for example, the group of like Phil Buxbaum and others, they have such knowledge on all these optical properties, and they are pushing some of those phenomena into the X-ray regime. If you go through the numbers, if I'm not mistaken, everything just gets so much harder with these shorter wavelengths, and that's holding us a little bit back. But on the other hand, it's also very exciting because you can get access to information which you just cannot get with visible light. So yes, so the answer is, short answer is yes, but baby steps, absolute baby steps compared to what laser people have been doing for almost like 20 years or even longer, right? So we're just starting to try to get in that direction, yes.
We have a question from the Zoom audience. Can tabletop HHG experiments be used for studying photosynthesis?
Not to my knowledge, not on the protein, because the you need to have the sample is too dilute. But if you are thinking about model catalysts, for example, for water splitting or other catalysts, which are using transition metal compounds, that can be done with HHG. And I'm looking at Ryan. I think Ryan's former group have actually done some work in that direction. So yeah, unfortunately, the the work on photosynthesis because of certainly on the manganese cluster, that it's such a dilute system that the first of all the power, but also the wavelength of XUV is not suited for such work.
Thanks for a great talk. I guess one of the motivations for studying photosynthesis is to try to improve on it. Do you think there's much potential for that? And if so, in which ways?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And I have to say, I'm not as much of an expert in this field, in particular in the artificial photosynthesis. I know a lot of groups are working on it. And some people say even, oh, we already have a decent cobalt catalyst, etc. I think that the interest in the natural system persists for two reasons. First of all, nature uses earth abundant materials, and a lot of catalysts, even the ones we have in our cars, it's just you cannot scale. If you need platinum or rubidium, you cannot scale it to large amounts. And so having a catalyst working with iron, manganese, and cobalt, etc., is a huge advantage. In fact, it's basically required. The other thing why the community actually looks at photosystem two, even those who don't study photosystem two, is because the chemistry is really unusual. If you think it's incredibly difficult to split a water molecule. If you wanted to do it by heat, you would need 60,000 degrees Celsius to rip it open. And yet there is this plant in your leaf outside, which uses sunlight at room temperature, and it just flop and pops out one after the other. How to overcome these energy barriers, how finely tuned this molecule is to accomplish that, is of interest also to those who do artificial photosynthesis. And of course, myself and the group, we are also just curious about it because we just like it. So we think it's such a cool protein. And even if we never build any catalyst out of it, to find out how it works would make us totally happy.
Thank you, Uwe. This was absolutely spectacular. I have a bit off topic. I wonder if you know much about isotopes, and specifically about isotope fractionation during photosynthesis. The first enzyme, Rubisco, strongly fractionates for carbon, so the it selects for the lighter isotope, so the natural abundance is basically 1% carbon 13 and 99 carbon 12. And when a Rubisco actually undergoes, which is the first reaction, it catalyzes the first reaction during the photosynthesis cycle, it actually selects for the light isotopes preferentially, so much so that any of the sugars that come from photosynthesis are immensely lower in their isotopic, what's called delta C13, compared to anything else. And so you can always tell what has been photosynthesized and what has not. I wonder if this also happens for oxygen, because for some reason, nobody ever writes about isotopes and oxygen in photosynthesis. Well, I wonder why.
Well, I mean, thank you. This is, of course, a great comment. And I have the only thing. So the one thought I have is that basically from the chemistry, right, from the chemistry, there shouldn't be a difference. But what is different with an isotope is, of course, the mass. And so that means when vibrational energies play a role, isotopes are critically important. We cannot drink D2O, it would kill us because our body is just fine-tuned to the vibrational frequencies of H2O and not of D. And I think probably the reason why nature selects a carbon 12 rather than 13 might have to do with that kind of dynamics of the vibrations. Now I can tell you my colleague, Johannes Messinger, he's a professor at University of Uppsala. He has actually, he's a pioneer in PS2, and he has used oxygen isotopes to measure actually where and how the oxygen evolves, because then he can measure them when it comes out. And so he has used, I forgot which isotope it is, but he has used an oxygen isotope. And I don't believe he assumes in his study that it reacts differently, because otherwise his results would be all wrong, and his results seem to be very good actually. So short answer, it has been done, and I don't think there's evidence that in the oxygen evolution, the isotope makes a difference, different to the carbon case. Now, why that is, I don't really know. Yeah. Now, Johannes would be a better person to answer that question, because he had probably thought very deeply about it, and I'm happy to. We can get in contact with him. He's a collaborator on all these papers also.
Okay, we have another audience or Zoom question. How does splitting water in the example of swimming pool compare with electrolysis using solar energy for production of hydrogen and oxygen?
The swimming pool example doesn't tell you how you split it, right? The swimming pool just tells you how much energy you gain by splitting it. And everyone who does it with electrolysis, and that's what people do, and using sunlight, they have to make this equation, how effectively they can convert actually sunlight or another form of let's say electricity into creating and splitting the water. And that's exactly the name of the game. That's what everyone is constantly thinking about. What I'm saying is, with this example, and that's, I still cannot get my head around this example. What I'm saying is that we need to appreciate two things. Our life on Earth only happens because we have about 21% oxygen in our atmosphere. It delivers all the fuel. When we fly across the ocean, we transport only 1/4 of the mass, because we suck in the O2 and emit the CO2, and we don't have to carry it when we fly across. If we wouldn't have this oxygen-rich atmosphere, nothing would work. And so, and the second thing, the sun produces 10,000 times more energy every second on Earth than we will ever need. It would be stupid not to use it. We need to use the sun.
Thanks again for this really great talk. I loved your connection with ancient manuscripts and modern studies as well. Are you excited about anything right now in the ancient manuscript side?
Yes, the answer is yes. If you want, I'll tell you very briefly. We have, Gutenberg has been, he's kind of made one of the biggest invention of the, Now we are talking about which century is that, like of the second millennium, namely the printed press. After Gutenberg, information was, it's similar to what's happening now, I would say, with the internet. Before Gutenberg, people had to copy it by hand. Information didn't go very quick. After Gutenberg, you have movable type press and information just disseminates like crazy. That was one of the reasons of the Age of Renaissance and all these great discoveries which came. Now, the Koreans and in China, there has been a movable type press before Gutenberg. There's a famous book called Jigchi, and there's another book called, it's a Confucius, a book about Confucius, which was printed about 70 years before Gutenberg. And we know it was printed with movable type press. And so the question arises in the science community or in some scientific communities, did Gutenberg know about the work east? It is possible, because the Silk Road had already existed. And there's even, some people even argue there might have been a papal delegation in Korea, which brought back maybe some of those movable type sets. There is not the slightest threat of any solid evidence for that, but it's out there. In fact, even our former vice president Al Gore once gave a talk where he said, oh, the Koreans invented the press, and a lot of people were unhappy about that. Because we really, I mean, yes, they did, but it didn't make it, it didn't go grow. The question, the more important question is, did Gutenberg do it independently or did he not? So we have now, my little team, we have access to an original Gutenberg Bible, the 36-line Bible, and to the original Confucius early print. And we are going to use XRF, and we are going to look for trace elements, and we are playing detective. Do we see any evidence that any in these papers, inks, whatever, maybe traces from thing are related to each other or not? So that would be our next experiment.
Thank you for this wonderful talk. I had like more of a general question for you, which is, I understand that this field is as in effect like 20 some years old. How did you find yourself drawn into it? Like, what was your trajectory of getting into X-Fels?
Oh, that's a really good question. Thank you. Like most of what I have done in my life, really by chance, I would say. I was basically at the right place when I moved to SLAG. I had no intention to ever do any X-ray laser research, but when we were there, it just came about, and we noticed it, and we said, wow, and we said like, oh, we need to take advantage of this, and if I would have been at ESRF or if I would have been somewhere else, I probably would still have not done a single X-ray laser experiment so far. So that's the honest answer.
Do we have any other questions? All right. Well, again, thank you, Professor Bergmann, for the wonderful talk. Thanks to all of you again for coming for the lively discussion. If you would like, we will have a reception just if you exit through the back of the forum here. We have been asked, you can go outside, but please no alcohol outside. You can bring food out if you want to kind of spill out into the sidewalk. That's okay. So do we have anything else they need to finish on, Mark, Uwe?
Thank you. I just want to thank everyone again.
Thanks.